My name is Tom Mikkelsen. I'm the president and scientific director of the Ontario Brain Institute, and welcome you here tonight. Thank you for everyone that's joining us here, and those who are tuning in online via TV Ontario. The Ontario Brain Institute, or OBI, is a provincially funded non-for-profit that aims to make Ontario a world leader in brain research, commercialization, and care. So we do this by creating partnerships between researchers, medical doctors, industry partners, patients, and others with lived experience, and their advocates to foster discovery and deliver innovative products and care that improves the lives of folks living with brain disorders. OBI was not simply funded to fund neuroscience research, but rather to ensure that science has both health and economic impact. This means that collaboration and partnerships, like I've described, are critical, and they depend on the focused patient advocacy, involvement from industry, and the many ministries of government, which is essential to achieve shared success. So I'd like to thank the community-based organizations and companies that are represented in the room tonight. The services and products they offer make an impact on care and well-being of patients and others living with lived experience with brain injury. In the interest of sort of a high-level overview of what the OBI does, we fund and manage five large research programs across the province. We call these integrated discovery programs. They engage researchers, medical doctors, patients, industry, and policymakers, and bring this together in the auspices of a big data enterprise we call Brain Code. The programs we fund and support include depression, epilepsy, cerebral palsy, the neurodevelopmental disorders, including autism, ADHD, and others, and the large family of neurodegenerative disorders, including Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and others. Most recently, we've begun laying the groundwork for a new effort in concussion, which is an underrepresented and underrecognized healthcare problem. You're going to hear much more about concussion later on this evening as part of the program. But essentially, of course, concussion is a brain injury, and every year they affect more than 150,000 people in Ontario alone. Now, we don't understand the complex story of concussion and what is actually happening in the brain, and these uncertainties need to be addressed to improve care and improve outcomes. We need to start with understanding. So OBI's new proposed concussion initiative is called CONNECT, Concussion Ontario Network, Neuroinformatics to Enhance Clinical Care and Translation. Harnessing the power of big data and a lot of the machine learning and artificial intelligence strategies you may have read about, this program is going to work on discovering new tools to diagnose concussion, to personalize treatments for individuals, and test brand new interventions focused on speeding recovery and preventing re-injury. You'll hear more about why those are so important as part of the program. It also focuses to bring industry partners from all over the world toward this problem of brain injury. So OBI believes that bringing all these players together under one roof, this strong alliance of physicians, researchers, patient and industry partners, are critical to address the problem of concussion. It's also important to highlight that Canada already has significant expertise and is recognized internationally for expertise in concussion. And the Ontario-based researchers we're going to hear about, as well as others from across the country, play a significant role on the international stage, especially in this avenue of concussion. So we have some excellent presentations coming up, but right now I get the opportunity to share greetings from His Excellency the Right Honourable David Johnson, the Governor General of Canada, who sends his regrets for not being able to be here tonight. But I quote from his letter, says, "I'm delighted to extend greetings to everyone in attendance at Bruising Your Brain, What Science and Sport Say About Concussion, presented by the Ontario Brain Institute. My wife, Sharon, and I are sports enthusiasts, and as such, we know well the devastating impact that brain injuries can have. Such injuries affect the individual directly, but in many cases, they can also have an impact on the families, loved ones, and caregivers. There is still so much to discover to unlock the mysteries of the human brain, which is why it's so important to establish partnerships, exchange information, and share resources. Today's dialogue will go far in helping us to raise awareness and increase the safety of all those who love to play sports. Thank you for all that you do for the health of Canadians, and I wish you a wonderful talk." That's David Johnson, the Governor General of Canada. So now, another opportunity, I'd like to introduce and welcome a special guest, The Honourable Elizabeth Dowdeswell was appointed as Ontario's 29th Lieutenant Governor, Lieutenant Governor, following a distinguished public service career. As Lieutenant Governor, her mandate focuses on Ontario in the world and sustainability, including its three interrelated components, environmental stewardship, inclusive economic prosperity and innovation, and social and cultural inclusion. So ladies and gentlemen, mesdames et messieurs, please join me in welcoming the Honourable Elizabeth Dowdeswell, Lieutenant Governor of Ontario.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good evening, bonsoir, bonjour. I'm so pleased to have been invited by the Ontario Brain Institute to attend and to learn from this talk this evening, Bruising Your Brain. Please allow me first to begin by recognizing the ancient and enduring presence of First Nations and Métis people in Ontario and acknowledge that we're gathered on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the New Credit. It gives me great pleasure to follow in the footsteps of His Excellency, our Governor General, although let me hasten to say that I cannot claim to be a renowned hockey player, either past or present. But together we share an interest in health innovation, sport, and certainly the work of the renowned Ontario Brain Institute. As we've just heard, concussions in sport are a focus of His Excellency the Governor General. Consequently, in December, he hosted a very successful conference on this issue, and the testimonials from athletes, including Mr. Lindros, were very compelling. Certainly here in Ontario, people are taking an increased interest in what has been called a silent epidemic. The passing of Rowan's Law Advisory Committee Act last June is just one example of this, and I'm sure that many of you here eagerly await its findings and recommendations related to head injuries in sport. I happily leave the public discussion to those more knowledgeable than me, and I look forward to a very fruitful and engaged public debate. I know that His Excellency is particularly concerned by declining rates of young people's participation in sport. But we also want to ensure that we participate as safely as possible. And certainly some parents are worried, perhaps with reason, that their children might get concussions. At the Ottawa conference, a number of important questions were discussed. Is there a need to change the culture of sport in order to de-emphasize potentially harmful contact and aggression? If there is, how do we do so? And how can we reassure parents that sports are indeed safer? And when concussions occur, how can they best be managed? So tonight we're going to be exposed to the emerging science and technology as we seek to better understand concussions. We're fortunate that our province, and indeed our country, is a hub for innovation and a leader in brain research. And I'm certainly intrigued by the work that's being undertaken through some 800 neuroscience researchers in this province alone. Already their work is hugely helpful to Canadians of all generations, from young Ontarians who are born with cerebral palsy and neurodevelopmental disorders, to our aging population, which may come to depend on newly developed brain technology. But our focus this evening is on concussions, and I'm eager to hear about some of the innovative and diverse ways in which research is helping us to better understand, diagnose, treat, and prevent concussions. So thanks to the Ontario Brain Institute for hosting this talk this evening, for your dedication to addressing this issue, and for your commitment to collaboration with researchers and leaders from across the country. Mr. Lindros, Dr. Emory, Dr. Zemek, we look forward to your insights. May your efforts inspire all of us to find solutions, for there's very little that we can't achieve when we actually all come together. Thank you. Merci. Miigwech.
All right. Thank you, Your Honor. And now I'd like to get on with the program and introduce our speaker. First of all, Dr. Carolyn Emory is the Associate Dean of Research in the Faculty of Kinesiology at the University of Calgary. She's a physiotherapist and sports injury epidemiologist. Her research focuses primarily on injury prevention in child and adolescent sports and education and recreation. Dr. Emory, best known for her research program in injury and concussion risk in youth ice hockey, including evaluation of policy related to body checking, which hopefully she'll speak of this evening. In addition, her research associated with the development and evaluation of prevention strategies to decrease the risk of injuries in hockey, soccer, basketball, and junior high school has led to a significant public health impact in injury reduction in youth sport. Dr. Roger Zemek is a pediatric emergency physician and scientist at the Children's Hospital of Eastern Ontario, CHEO. His research is focused on pediatric concussion and post-concussion syndrome following pediatric head injury. He's the principal investigator of multiple peer-reviewed grants with expertise in pediatric concussion. He's the principal investigator for the Predicting Persistent Post-Concussion Problems in Pediatrics, or 5P study, the largest concussion study to date, which you'll hear about later on, and maybe he can say that five times fast. He is also the PI of the PEDCARE study that aims to determine the optimal balance of physical activity versus rest in kids following concussion. Tonight's moderator, a real treat, André Picard, is an award-winning health journalist who's been with the Globe and Mail for over 20 years. He's a best-selling author, renowned speaker, and advocate for improving health of Canadians. He's widely considered the top health journalist in the country. His approach to researching, documenting, and sharing health issues through the eyes of patients, healthcare workers, caregivers, and other individuals provides compelling insight to everyday challenges. He's received numerous awards and was also named Canada's first public health hero by the Canadian Public Health Association and the champion of mental health by the Canadian Alliance on Mental Illness and Mental Health. Before they begin, though, I'd like to invite Eric Lindros to come to you all. He'll be joining the speakers over the panel after the presentations have adjourned. Of course, he needs no introduction, but over the course, I'm going to give you one anyway. Over the course of his distinguished NHL career, he's accumulated career totals of 372 goals, 493 assists, and 865 points. Six-time NIH All-Star, was a recipient of the L.B. Pearson Award, Hart Trophy, and last November, he was inducted into 2016 Hockey Hall of Fame class. Today he's a major force pushing for a concerted approach to concussion research, and we're thrilled to have his support and his presence here this evening. So Eric, please.
Thank you very much for that introduction, and thanks for everyone coming here tonight and joining us. I think that if we were to attempt to do this about 20 years ago, I'm not sure that we would have so many attend. And the mere fact that we're all here together today shows that we're making headway. This alone shows that we're making headway. So thank you for coming. Since the mid-90s, dealing with concussions has been part of my life. My brother Brett was a first-round draft pick to the New York Islanders. He was forced to retire after only a year and a half of professional hockey due to concussions. I too experienced many concussions, but I felt I could still contribute to the game at the pro level. I was a shadow of my former self. I had a huge fear of going through the middle of the ice. And overall, I still had some good years, but I retired very bitter at the way that things had unfolded and wanted to get involved with how concussions were understood, treated, and could we prevent them. As a start, I teamed up with London Health Sciences and Western University, joined See the Line. See the Line is an annual concussion symposium open to the public that brings together top researchers and specialists from different fields of concussion to collaborate and discuss possible common threads. Personally, I enjoy learning more about the varying views and recent research findings. See the Line has taken place for the last 5 years, and because of the terrific feedback and significant interest, we're working on bringing this concept nationally. I'm also part of Rowan's Law Advisory Committee. We've been working very hard to find some solutions that address the coroner's recommendations following Rowan's death. Rowan Stringer was a 17-year-old rugby player from Ottawa who passed away from second impact syndrome. Much of what we are working on includes better communication between coaches, parents, teammates, teachers, and friends. taking a precautionary approach to how games can be played more safely with the objective to reduce incidents of concussion is perhaps a cultural shift in sport. Most recently, I've teamed up with longstanding Montreal Canadiens team doctor, Dr. Mulder, and together we have approached the NHL on multiple occasions, including most recently in LA at the All-Star Game, the Concussion Working Group, with an ask to financially support research in the areas of diagnostics and concussion management. Our outcome from this for support is still pending, and we remain committed to a positive result. This is my nice way of saying they haven't called back. Today I'm here to learn more about different views as to what can be done to further improve the prevention, diagnosis, and treatment of concussions. We will hear from two experts who specialize in sport concussion and concussion in children. And while my personal experience with concussion comes from a career in the NHL, it's important to remember that the vast majority of concussions in North America, about 70%, are caused by motor vehicle accidents and falls. Recent media coverage of sports-related concussions has brought more attention to the growing issue of concussion safety in sports, but there's still much more work to be done with this traumatic brain injury at large. The main reason I've decided to push for more research is because there is a difference. This is where a difference can really be made, where we can actually move the yardstick towards a better understanding and better outcomes for people affected by concussions. I've always been an advocate for collaboration, and because of this, I'm thrilled to hear about the way the Ontario Brain Institute is helping people work together. We know that Canada is already a global leader when it comes to concussion research, and if we've got some of the best concussion experts in the world, then why not enable them to collaborate? While we don't know enough about concussion, we know that it is extremely complex and it requires a multidisciplinary approach in order to tackle it. That means that we need different kinds of expert working together on common goals, sharing data, and playing team science. And that's exactly what the Ontario Brain Institute Connect research program is all about, bringing together over 15 leading research centers and hospitals with top expertise in concussion by finding some of the best and insisting on impact. I'm really excited to see the world's experts coming together on this. Some great work has been done, but there's a lot more to go. I hope to see more of this type of collaboration in the future. Thanks again for everyone for being here tonight. I hope we can all take away something that will have a positive impact on our brain health as well as how we view concussions. And as the Governor General said in early December, we can do better. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here, and I want to thank the Ontario Brain Institute for inviting me to join the panel tonight. Eric, you're going to be a tough act to follow, and I got to do that twice today, so looking forward to the panel discussion later. I just want to say a few words. I think that we're not going to solve this problem without champions, and those champions are not the researchers. Those champions are in the community. They're Eric. Your champion in our children's lives as a player, and now certainly in what we want to do to solve this problem. So thank you for all the work you do. So my focus tonight is going to be around prevention of concussion, and I do a lot of my work in youth sport and recreation. I'm a physiotherapist, I'm an epidemiologist, and I'm interested in how we can have a public health impact in reducing the risk of concussion in kids, and specifically focused on youth sport and recreation. I came at this a little bit also as a player and as a coach and watching my kids play hockey growing up, and I think that it really is going to take a village to solve this problem moving forward. So tonight I'm going to talk a little bit about the public health impact of concussion and give some evidence-informed examples of how we can prevent concussions, specifically in children and adolescents. And also how evidence can inform practice and policy to have a public health impact. So this is a definition of concussion coming from the 2012 International Consensus on Sport Concussion meeting, which occurred in Zurich. And people refer to this consensus in a lot of different ways in looking forward at prevention, but also how we diagnose and identify concussions, prognosis, as well as treatment strategies specifically related to sport concussion. And we just had another meeting in 2016 in October. In about 3 weeks, we will we'll be able to see the recommendations from that consensus meeting. And so this definition may change slightly, but certainly is a brain injury. It's complex, and it's induced by biomechanical forces. And I think we can look forward to the updated consensus in a couple of weeks. So there are a lot of symptoms that are related to concussion, and some of the most common ones that we see in youth sport concussion are headache, neck pain, and dizziness. And I think that as we go forward, this is how people really think about you know, how we diagnose concussion. People can understand, they can relate to symptoms. But I think we can move forward and think about much more complex ways. Actually, we can understand these symptoms and understand how these things can resolve for kids more quickly with different treatments. So we're going to play a little game. I can't see you, this is truth or myth, and it's called Mythbusters. And so you can just speak up and tell me whether you think it's a truth or a myth. So if you weren't knocked out, then you don't have a concussion. Yeah. Excellent. Speaking to the converted, less than 10% of concussions involve loss of consciousness. Loss of consciousness is not needed to diagnose a concussion. Having multiple concussions in sport increases your risk of having another concussion. Truth? Everybody's saying truth. Excellent. I don't need to be up here. You already know all the answers. An athlete experiencing one concussion is 2 to 8 times more likely to sustain another concussion, depending on the context. Number 3, if there are no instant symptoms right after the event, then there's no concussion. Myth. Symptoms can evolve over hours or days. Individuals with delayed onset of symptoms may be more likely to have longer-term recovery. Any contact to the head or the body causing rapid head movement can cause a concussion. A trauma may occur to the head, or it may be a force transmitted to the head through the body and result in a concussion. And in fact, many concussions, for example, in youth ice hockey, there's no contact of the head to another player and or the ice or the boards. So when we do research in injury prevention, and specifically concussion prevention, it's important that we have a good, valid measurement of the extent of the injury problem. What is the burden? We need to use surveillance methodologies. That might be in emergency rooms, and Dr. Zemek will talk a little bit more about that later. Or it might be in the community, and using valid injury surveillance in schools and or community sport. And this helps us to understand risk factors for concussion, which will then lead us to the development of interventions to hopefully prevent concussions. And then by introducing the intervention and using that surveillance, whether we're using randomized controlled trials or more observational designs where we're following some groups of individuals that go through an intervention, a prevention intervention, and others that would be more in a control group, to evaluate that using the validated injury surveillance at play. So we've done a lot of this work in youth ice hockey, other sports, as well as schools. The public health burden, we expect about more than 2 million concussions annually in North America. Now, 70% of these are in individuals under the age of 19 years. 60% of these are in sport and recreation. And we expect that 1 in 20 youth will sustain a sport and recreational concussion each year and seek medical attention for that concussion. Now, 30% of these are recurrent. So we also know that we have kids with previous concussion history that we can target with secondary prevention strategies. Now, many people who have children that play in sports are concerned if their children have had one concussion because their increased risk is greater after they've had one concussion. Now, in terms of long-term recovery, actually only about 30% are symptomatic after 1 month and 15% after 3 months. But this can be an incredible burden on the child as well as the family. The child can't participate in the regular activities or even sometimes return to school. So long-term concussions, long-term consequences not only include the inability to participate in sport and recreation, and we expect about 8% of kids to be unable to play in their given sport in an organized sport each year. They drop out because of injury, and many of these are concussions. Reduced school attendance in the early phase, and for some kids longer term. We also have another epidemic on our hands if kids aren't participating in sport. Reduced physical activity will lead to a greater epidemic related to overweight and obesity. There's psychosocial consequences, which are significant to both a child and family, and healthcare and indirect costs are high. So in order to develop prevention strategies, we need to understand risk factors. These are Pee Wee ice hockey players prior to the policy change that disallowed body checking at that age group. But the risk of concussion is complex, and it's the interaction of many different risk factors, some of which you see here, that are intrinsic to the individual. Things like, we know the kids who are the smallest on the ice are at greater risk when there's body checking allowed, for example. And there's other extrinsic factors like the equipment they're wearing, the type of helmet, whether that helmet fits well. But over time, and a lot of work over the last 15 years, has indicated that body checking is, independent of the other risk factors, one of the most consistent risk factors for injury and concussion in youth ice hockey. So there is quite a body of literature evaluating concussion prevention strategies in youth sports. However, the four sports where we have a recurrent theme are in ice hockey, American football, rugby, and soccer, four of the sports where we see the greatest burden of concussion. So some of the strategies relate to protective equipment, the rules of the game, training strategies, as well as fair play rules. So I just wanted to share some of the literature with you in terms of the evidence that we have around preventing concussions in youth. So first of all, protective equipment. When we look at helmets, most of this work is done in youth American football. And we know that potentially additional padding over the jaw region may reduce the risk of concussion in this particular sport in youth. As well, appropriate helmet fit may reduce symptom severity and duration. And certainly in some sports, including, of course, in the NHL, if the helmet stays on, that's also very, very important. And so helmet fit is a significant area that we're doing more work in. And in the studies looking at youth American football, there's no differences by helmet age or helmet manufacturer. We also hear a lot about headgear, and examples of some of the work that's been done in rugby and soccer actually show no evidence of a protective effect with standard or more padded headgear in rugby, and very limited evidence to support any protective effect of headgear in soccer as well. Now, mouth guards have been a controversial topic, and most of the work is done in football, rugby, and ice hockey, and there's inconsistent evidence regarding custom versus off-the-shelf mouth guards. But certainly when you combine all of the evidence, there is some suggestion that mouth guards may in fact reduce the risk of concussion. And there's more work to be done in this area because actually if we're looking at adults, for example, the adults who perhaps play differently, perhaps not more safety conscious, may also be more likely to wear a mouth guard. So this is some of the concern about some of the research in this area. For kids, I think that's less of a concern. We've been working on understanding and evaluating body checking policy in youth ice hockey for some time. And our original work was actually to compare the risk of concussion and all injury in PB players, 11 and 12-year-old players, in Quebec, where there had been policy disallowing body checking for some time, since the 70s, compared to Alberta, where all kids who are 11 and 12 body checked, regardless of level of play. And in that original study, we showed a fourfold greater risk in players who were in Alberta compared to Quebec. There was a lot of publicity and media attention following that research, and there were several studies, some of which were done here in Ontario as well. And this all led to a vote at Hockey Canada Board to ban body checking in Pee Wee players 11 and 12 years old across the country. So as a result, we were actually able to evaluate that policy change in Alberta before and after the policy change, and we demonstrated a 64% reduction in all concussions and a 44% reduction in concussions leading to more time loss in the severe concussion category. If we translate this to what does this actually mean in terms of frequency of concussion, we estimate a reduction of over 580 concussions in Alberta Pee Wee players alone and over 4,800 concussions in Canada annually. It's a pretty big effect. If you're an individual player, like Bruce, number 15, who's 11 years old, he's an elite player and had a previous history of concussion, and he played in Alberta in 2012-13 season. And then there's John, who's number 5. He's also 11, an elite player, and had a history of previous concussion. And he's playing in Alberta the year following the policy change. So Bruce's risk of concussion is 26%. And this is now reduced to 6% following that policy change. So it's not the only element of risk in youth ice hockey, but it did have a significant impact. And as we go forward, we are also evaluating changes in bantam and midget non-elite levels of play. So in some jurisdictions, 70% of players are not playing in games with body checking allowed. Now, in contrast to that, there was a change at the NHL level, but also across youth ice hockey in Canada and the U.S. It was zero tolerance for head contact rule. So penalties and enforcement was greater for any contact to the head, be it intentional or unintentional. And we were able to follow elite players in Pee Wee and Bantam age groups, so this is 11 to 14 year olds before that policy change and 2011 and following that policy change. And what we found was actually not only no protective effect of this particular change in youth ice hockey players, but we also found an increased concussion rate following that change. Now, that likely had a lot to do with what we would call referral bias, more reporting of concussions because of more attention in the media. We know more about concussions. We're certainly in a situation of being better at diagnosing them than prior. So we have seen this sort of apparent increase in concussion risk. Now, incidentally, this was evaluated at the NHL, in the NHL as well, where it was a different finding. And I think that may play to the fact that we have very experienced referees in the NHL compared to young individuals who are refereeing in 11 and 12-year-old ice hockey. Now, some training strategies in youth American football, for example, and these relate to restricting contact in practices, combined with coach training, seems to reduce practice concussion rates. And there's another strategy around helmetless tackle training. This is for 5 minutes twice a week in practice. May also reduce the number of head contacts over a season of play. However, this has not yet translated to evidence that actually demonstrates a reduction in concussion risk. A lot of talk around fair play, particularly in youth ice hockey, and this is these are programs generally within tournament play where points are assigned for low penalty minutes. So some incentive for fair play. But so far there hasn't been any evidence to suggest a reduction in concussion rate with fair play rules. So as I mentioned, part of the international consensus on sport concussion, which took place in Berlin in October, was a review of strategies that can be used effectively to reduce the risk of concussion in sport. In total, we included 48 studies in this particular review, and those will be published in the next few weeks. I wanted to talk a little bit about concussion management and education, and just to mention a PhD student working in our Sport Injury Prevention Research Center, Amanda Black, who's an athletic therapist and just finishing her PhD. And she set out to examine the effectiveness of a concussion education intervention for players, parents, and coaches, not just in changing knowledge, but also beliefs and behavior. And so the particular tool, online tool that we're using that was developed by Dr. Shalina Babool at UBC and her colleagues and that we're evaluating is called the CAT, or the Concussion Awareness Training Tool. Now, some of these behaviors we're talking about, player behaviors, reporting concussion symptoms to an adult in the first place, the coach removing a player that has a suspected concussion from play and not allowing them to return to play till they've been reviewed by a physician. And from a parent perspective, taking the child to a physician for assessment and clearance to return to play and return to learn. So if we look at the Zurich Consensus Guidelines from 2012, and these will change a little bit in terms of the new consensus coming forward, I think that you'll recognize a lot of these things here, particularly with all the discussion in Ontario around Rowan's Law, and I think that some of those key points are around identification of signs, symptoms, mechanisms related to concussion, removal from play, and not allowing that player to go back until they've been referred and cleared by physician. As well, education for coaches, players, and parents being mandated, as well as a lot of attention on the return to play and return to learn protocols. So the participants in concussion management, in this case we're talking about the player, the parent, the coach, and then of course all of the healthcare practitioners that may be involved in the case of a concussion, and clearly the physician who makes that decision if that child can return to play. Some of the consequences of inappropriate management include worsening symptoms, prolonged recovery, and more severe consequences and long-term consequences. Amanda set out in her work to understand the barriers associated with behaviors surrounding concussion, and just to highlight some of those things, and this is what was from talking with parents and parent coaches, and some of the themes that came through around those barriers include parents believing that their player is okay and that they can return. And parents underestimating the severity of the collision and or the symptoms, and not wanting their player to miss an important game. These are some of the themes that the parents are talking about. Some facilitators, however, if they're looking for an appropriate explanation by a qualified person to understand what's going on with their child, believing that seeing a doctor is important, and perhaps a team protocol enforcing it, not allowing children to return to play until they've seen a physician. Persistent symptoms can be varied, and they differ for everybody. They may be physical in nature, such as neck pain, dizziness, headache, or they may be more cognitive in nature. Perhaps sleep disturbances or mental health disorders are some of the persistent symptoms that we're all looking at and trying to solve. So as a result, because there's such a diversity of symptoms that sometimes are prolonged in 15% of individuals after 3 months, the approaches are multifaceted, multimodal physiotherapy, addressing the cervical, the neck, and the vestibular system, psychological treatments, cognitive rehabilitation, pharmacotherapies, and an attention on exercise, an exercise prescription. And Dr. Zemek is going to talk about that from his studies a little bit later. I want to talk a little bit about Dr. Catherine Schneider's work around specialized orthopedic and vestibular rehabilitation compared to a control in a randomized controlled trial. And the participants that were in the treatment group were 10 times more likely to be medically cleared to return to sport at 8 weeks by a physician who was blinded to the treatment program. So this has led to a much larger randomized trial and will lead to some multi-center work. So some take-home messages: evidence-informed concussion prevention is key. We can have a huge impact if we can prevent these concussions in the first place. We need to find better and more novel ways to do that. There's a need for a greater understanding of barriers in concussion management. There's increasing evidence for effectiveness of physiotherapy and other treatments. And there's a significant need for prevention research among all sport and recreation participants to have the greatest public health impact. So I just wanted to acknowledge that the work that we do in concussion and that our colleagues do across the country in concussion management and diagnosis and prognosis, it requires a lot of collaboration with a lot of people who have different expertise, community partners on board, and champions in the field to help us to do our work. So certainly it's going to be exciting going forward to see the kind of work we can do when we all pull together nationally with our community partners to try to answer some of these big questions around preventing concussions and interventions that can get our kids back to perhaps return to play, but to their life, to school, and their regular activities. So on that, I want to thank you very much for having me and for your time tonight. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I want to again thank the OBI for hosting such a wonderful event, and it's an absolute privilege to be with you tonight. My objective for the audience this evening is to be able to have a better understanding of how common concussion is. Hopefully by the end, everyone will have a better sense of how we can identify who may go on to have persisting symptoms. And then at the end, we're going to briefly talk about the potential association between early physical activity and ongoing symptoms. So I just want to start by a quick show of hands. How many of you in the audience have had a concussion? I see a lot of hands out there, and as you can see, my hand is up, and that's one of the reasons why I study this topic, is because I have such a passion for trying to get more answers. As Carolyn had talked about earlier, the concussion has been called a silent epidemic by the Center of Disease Control. This is not just because of the fact that it was underappreciated, perhaps, and people were told to perhaps just get back in the game or not worry about their symptoms, but the silent epidemic comes to the fact that patients, even now, do not always seek medical care, so it's very hard to estimate the exact number of patients that come in to seek medical care across either Ontario or Canada-wide. What we did as our team recently looked at the number of visits in Ontario in children with concussion, and as you can see, the numbers had been increasing quite steadily, almost at a rate of two times the factors from about 2003 to 2010. But then something happened in 2011, January 1st, which had led to a massive spike in the number of healthcare visits that we see. And that event was the concussion of a Canadian icon, and I think the media attention to that has led to more visits. So while we certainly can empathize and want the any individual patient's concussion not to have those symptoms, it has certainly led to more awareness of the problem, and has at least led to more awareness of how important it is to answer these questions and do more research. So I work in the pediatric emergency department, and in Ottawa, where I work, we see in our hospital about 1,000 concussions that are new each year. So if you think about that, on any given day, we're seeing about three kids who come in with new concussions. And I thought I would pick a case vignette of a very typical type of patient. So this is not a real child, but a hypothetical case of that's one very representative of what we see. So let's say there's a young woman, she's 14 years old and collided during soccer. She did not lose consciousness, she remembers what happened, but she was initially unsteady on her feet on the field, and she was slow to answer some of the initial questions her coach was asking her. She was complaining of headache and saying she felt foggy and tired, and they did the right thing and removed her from the game. So then she comes to see me in the emergency department, and as she waits in our waiting room with the loud noises and crying babies, her symptoms are getting worse with the bright lights and loud noises. And when the doctor talks to her and gets more history, we find out that she's never had a concussion before, never had migraines. When we do some questions to see how clearly she's thinking, she can remember number digits, she can remember some words, so she's thinking properly, at least as with regards to her cognition. But then we stand her up and do some balance testing, and we find that she's still a bit unsteady on her gait. So I diagnose her with a concussion, and then the very next thing her mother's going to ask me are two things, and this always happens. One, when's my child going to get better? Is it going to be a couple days? Is it going to be a couple weeks? What about that big tournament that we've already booked our travel plans to coming up out of town? And when can they get back to doing those things they love and want and need to do, and particularly their sport? It's particularly, when can they do that? When just the coach or the player wants? Is it when they feel perfectly back to normal? Or can they get doing something as they continue to improve? So those questions require evidence. And I found that when I was treating patients in the emergency department, we don't necessarily have the evidence for that. So I'm going to ask you the first question when the parents would ask her, ask me, or pretend you're the physician in the emergency department, how long, what do you think her risk is of having symptoms that last a month or more? By show of hands, how many of you think she has a low risk? Don't forget, she never had loss of consciousness or any of these other. How many think she's medium risk? And how many of you think high? So the medium group definitely is good at hedging their bets, but we'll talk about that in a moment. So can that led to the question, can we predict how long post-concussion symptoms last? And so that was the purpose of my research. And as Dr. Emory talked about, there are many types of symptoms that can happen. You could have physical, as mentioned, headache, etc. They could have psychological or mental problems. They could have emotional behavior problems and sleep problems. So when patients typically have what we say three or more symptoms that are new to them that are lasting more than a month, we call that PCS, or we'll call it PPCS for short. And so why is learning about PPCS important? Well, we know it can really impact children as they go through their school and go through their activities. This is based on this research that our team recently published, and I'll be showing you the study in a moment, but we showed in this sub-study that children who had symptoms that lasted a month or more had significantly more physical, emotional, social, and school problems than those children who also had concussion but improved within the first month. And as you can also see, there's a dotted line at the top. It may be hard to project for those near the back. Those whose symptoms had resolved basically get back to published norms, meaning children who haven't had concussion. But those who hadn't are still significantly below. But what's really interesting is both groups, whether your symptoms resolved or didn't, still have ongoing school functional problems that last up to 3 months or more following their concussion. And this can lead to not only impaired academic performance, but it could lead to children being in a depressed mood, they're missing their school, they're missing activities, and it could lead to this, again, lower quality of life. So in addition to providing the answer to the parent who asked me, when's my child going to get better, I think it can better lead to improved adherence to guidelines, and more importantly, allow us to target those who need the help most. So for example, if a concussion clinic has limited resources, we could target those patients at highest risk to get in sooner. And for those who may not need it, may not have to take up resources if we know that their symptoms are going to resolve in the matter of days. Further, being able to identify who's at higher risk is key for us to design future trials in which we examine one type of medication versus another, or one type of intervention, be it the vestibular therapy that Carolyn was talking about versus another. We want to be able to target those who are most likely to have ongoing symptoms to see if these interventions are effective. So I know Tom had his practice with alliteration, the predicting persistent post-concussive problems in pediatrics. I will now therefore call the 5P study from here on. And the goal of our 5P study was to derive a clinical prediction rule for PPCS using clinically available factors of children presenting to an emergency department following a concussion. So what do I mean by clinically available factors? I know that most children with concussion will not necessarily present to my tertiary or quaternary pediatric emergency department in an academic institution, and that most will be presenting to their community. And if I needed a fancy MRI experimental scanner or some very novel blood test that's only available to be shipped to Toronto, for example, having that blood test take 2 weeks to come back is not so helpful for someone in that small community hospital to give that advice. So I wanted to start with things that we could do right away and that could be universally applicable. And we have the ability, therefore, following up to refine this later in subsequent studies. But this was a starting point. And so what we used for this study was the Pediatric Emergency Research Canada Network, for which I'm a member, and we enrolled children across the entire country of Canada, across 9 hospitals demonstrated on the map above. And this was a great collaboration in which we were then able to get the patients that we needed, and it really allowed to get us both geographic diversity across the country as well. So as I mentioned, one of the things you need to have is 3 or more symptoms worse than your baseline. And if I were to ask any of you who have teenage children, how many of your children today may have felt fatigued or irritable or feeling mentally foggy, you may say that they are a 5 out of 6 on any given day. And what we're really looking, though, is the difference between how are you now versus how you perceived you were before the injury. And therefore, the difference between those two numbers is something that potentially could be attributable to the concussion rather than something else. So one of the things I talked about was the fact that when we tested her in the emergency department, she had some problems with balance. So now's the time for everyone to stand up and not fall asleep if you're fatigued. And we're going to do a quick little test to see what we would do in the emergency room as well. So one of the things we do to test for balance are 2 tests. So the first one is called the double leg stance, where your feet are next to each other. And so everyone's going to take that image on the left and put your feet together and your hands on your hip. And you bend your knees slightly. And then what you're going to do is close your eyes. So everyone's going to close their eyes for approximately 20 seconds. And what I would be looking to see, and everyone do it, so close your eyes and I'll just talk. And what I'm looking is, do you take your hands off your hips? Do you sway left and right? Are you taking a step forward? Are you opening your eyes? And if any of those things happen, for each of those events, you get a point. So you can open your eyes. You pass the first test. Now we see how we do on the harder one. Pretend there's a little soccer ball in front of you and give it a kick. And that's the foot that you kick the ball with is the one you put in front, and then you're going to get that same position. So hands on both hips, knees slightly bent, looking forward, but now you close your eyes. And it's pretending you're basically walking on an imaginary tightrope. And this is what the test we do is called the tandem test, and it's much harder to do. So again, we would do it for 20 seconds and count how many problems patients are having. So you can all open your eyes before I induce any concussions in the audience. And I thought I would share with you now the results of our study. So as I mentioned, this was a study across the country of Canada, of which we had 9 centers, and we enrolled over 3,000 children prospectively. What we were able to do is, although there were over 40 factors, so for example, loss of consciousness may have been important as a one-on-one, and maybe problems remembering may be a problem one-on-one, but when we do science, we also look at how do all the variables interact with each other. And when they interact with each other as a total, we found that there was basically 5 categories of predictors. So the first category is their demographics. So interestingly enough, we found that teenagers were at higher risk than lower age children. And we found that girls were at higher risk of having prolonged symptoms as compared to boys. The next category after their demographics was their past medical history. So patients who had prior concussion but recovered really quickly, it was almost the same as though they never had a concussion at all. But those who had a prior concussion that lasted more than a week were at higher risk. The other factor in past history was whether they had a history of migraine or not. The next was one of those cognitive questions. We asked patients if they were answering questions more slowly, and those who did had a higher risk. The reason I stood you all up and did that tandem stance is of the 70-plus things that we tested in the emergency room, that was one of the key findings and was the only physical exam finding, at least that we measured, that predicted symptoms. And the last was, of all those 20-plus initial symptoms that patients could have, it really boiled down to these three were the most predictive of ongoing symptoms, specifically headache, sensitivity to noise, and fatigue. And if you see in the column on the right, we've assigned points to each of those variables. And those were not just me picking what I think would be good, 0 or 1, or this one's more important, 2. It's based on the factors that were borne out in the statistics. So what we could do, though, is you could take all these points and add them up. And even in a busy emergency department, we emergency physicians can still add to 12. It's got a factor and a couple toes in there, but we're almost able to count it on two hands. And what we found is there was a very strong correlation between the number of points they have and then their eventual percentage who had persistent concussion symptoms. And you could see there was almost a low-risk group, which I highlighted in green, who had a risk of a total risk about 10% or less. And then there was a high-risk group who had pretty much 50% or more, and that's when their symptom point totals were 9 or greater. So what we were able to do is come up with this 5P rule, where if they had 3 or less points, they were low risk, between 4 or 8 medium risk, and 9 or above high risk. And so I thought we could go back to that young woman who came to our emergency department and apply her rule. And as you can just review her history, we can go through and we know that she's a teenager and that she's had no prior concussion and no history of migraine, but she does answer questions slowly. She does have her problems on that tandem stance. She does have headache, sensitivity, noise, and fatigue. So her total actually would be 10 points. And if you were to use the 5P rule, you'd actually see that she was high risk, which was maybe not what conventional wisdom has taught us. But one thing I've learned as a scientist, conventional wisdom is not always conventional, nor is it always wise. So now I've answered that first question to the parents. Now, I don't go and tell the family, bad news, you're high risk. I actually think it's very important to recognize that concussion is something that should improve, and children will get better. So I do say, you know what, your child's going to get better, but we're going to make sure we do some steps and make you get to into a specialist and have you get some close follow-up to ensure that you get as quick of the recovery as possible. So now that I've given her that information on what to expect and maybe tell them don't plan on necessarily going to that travel hockey tournament next weekend, the parents will, what's now? Because what happens typically is they come to the emergency, we say they have a concussion, we tell them they need to rest, and then parents sometimes put their kids in a home jail. They don't get to see their friends, they're not going to school, they're not doing the things they love to do. And I think we need to and can do better. So we need to address this second issue of what is the evidence for rest? Because when we develop guidelines, one of the things that the Ontario Neurotrauma Foundation has done is sponsor the development for the guidelines for diagnosing and management pediatric concussion, of which I led, but I know many of you in the audience who I've met today in meetings have taken part in this. And I also know, as Carolyn mentioned earlier, both the Zurich guidelines and now the soon Berlin guidelines have looked at these questions. And current recommendations state that protocols really should say you should avoid physical activity until your symptoms are better. But we are learning that maybe that concept of home jail is maybe not the best thing. We also know that in another form of brain injury, such as stroke, which is a severe traumatic brain injury in which sometimes there's even bleeding on the brain, doctors immediately, as soon as possible, get those patients out of bed and beginning rehabilitation. Whereas in concussion, we're doing the opposite. But we know that there's physiological, psychological, and functional benefits of early physical rehabilitation in these other fields. So we wanted to examine what is the true evidence behind these rest and guidelines. So I'm going to ask you again to vote. Does early physical activity reduce your risk of persistent symptoms at 1 month? So how many of you think yes? How many of you think no? And how many have no idea? And so what we wanted to do was investigate this to see if there was, if children did physical activity within their first week following their injury, did they have a lower risk, or what was their association of having ongoing symptoms at 1 month? And it used very advanced statistics and techniques, which I will not belabor you with, but what we found in summary is that children who did early physical activity was associated with reduced risk of having ongoing symptoms, about 25% versus 43%. And those association remained consistent even when we matched patients one-to-one as though they were otherwise identical patients. Further, we also found that patients really aren't following the guidelines very well, and most kids seem like they want to do physical activity even when they're having symptoms. So we really need to confirm this in what's called a randomized control trial in future research. And a randomized control trial is when patients come in and they don't know which one they're assigned to and get one treatment versus another. And that's something that I just wanted to announce that we've actually started to answer this, and I know there's teams in Calgary and elsewhere who also looking at the use of early physical activity or physical activity rehabilitation in general for patients with concussion. And this is something that's called the PEDCARE study that we've actually started, and I mention it here because Sick Kids is one of the sites along with CHEO and London. And the Pediatric Concussion Assessment of Rest and Exertion Study is something that hopefully will better elucidate what is the difference between those children who do early physical activity and those who do not. So I'm here speaking, but I want to really recognize that it is a massive team, and this is something that I could never have done on my own. And I have great support across not only Ontario, but all of Canada. And I'm really excited to moving to hearing some of your questions as we have our panel discussion. So thank you very much.
I think we're short one mic, but I'm sure someone will take care of that momentarily. So thank you, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the talks. They're quite fascinating. Now we're going to have a more informal discussion. Great, thank you. And I'm going to ask a few questions, and then we're going to give an opportunity for the audience to wave your hands. Even though I can see nothing, we'll bring up the house lights a little later and give you a chance to ask some questions at the end. So we've put Eric at center with two speedy wingers. I hope that works for you. Okay. So I want to start with you, Eric. I think a lot of people in the audience are wondering, how are you doing these days? You know, we know a little bit about your past, your concussion history, but how are you doing presently? How are you coping?
Well, I think my wife, Keena, is here tonight, and we have three kids under three. So I got laughing about Roger's list of, headache, fatigue. we're lining up for a few of those, but I'm doing great. I'm doing extremely well, and I'm just wanted to get on board and see if we can grab the group together. There's some wonderful minds out there. There's some great research that's being done, and let's pull it together and find a true solution here at various levels.
And tell me how you think the NHL is doing. The NHL, a lot of people. You know, there seems to be a lot more action, say, in the NFL, in football and soccer. They seem to be taking this more seriously than hockey. Is that fair?
I think protocol has greatly improved from the 90s. Greatly improved. They've done a fantastic job in that. Unfortunately, there's some lawsuits that are swirling around. There's some situations that, I don't want to speak to, but I would think that moving forward, let's keep that separate, and let's focus that we have done a great job on protocol. They have done a really good job on protocol, but there's such an area of research, and the influence of the NHL is, a dollar from them is like $3 from someone else. Just that power, that push, and we went and asked for a large sum of money from each individual team, and we think that there's a great area there for going at management and prognosis. Diagnostics.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Carolyn, maybe you could address that. Would it help your work? Would it help researchers? Would it make it better for kids if the NHL showed a little bit more leadership on this and spoke out about the gravity of this problem?
I think that's a great question. I can tell you that, you know, over time, they're not going to listen to researchers. Researchers aren't going to change policy and change practice. Hopefully, we will have partners and champions that will lead that charge and consider the evidence in making those decisions.
Now, you talked about body checking being eliminated in peewee hockey and bantam in some provinces. Are you suggesting we get rid of it in the NHL? How far should this go?
I don't think I ever suggested that. Okay. Would that be a good idea? Maybe fighting. That would be, you know, that's certainly a topic of conversation in elite levels of play. I think that what we're talking about here is young players with developing brains when they're 11 and 12 years old, and they continue to have developing brains from 13 through to 17. And so it's about minimizing that risk. It's about making decisions around non-elite levels of play, but still giving players that opportunity to develop the skill of body checking as they move forward in some of their hopes and dreams to be playing at that level one day.
And your research is pretty convincing, a 64% reduction in concussions when you get rid of body checking. But how do you make that culture change? That's pretty ingrained. Canadians, you know, we go out there and skate and we hit each other and we're tough. How do you change the culture?
Well, I think it, you know, it changes over time, and actually Hockey Canada, the folks I work with and meet with regularly there tell me that actually there's more, they get more positive feedback than they get negative feedback on that policy change. I think one of the things that we also have to do, though, is to evaluate what's happening in terms of behaviors on the ice, contact behaviors, what has happened there in terms of looking at, for example, video analysis. Hockey Canada is very, very strong on understanding how is this affecting the performance of our players. And some of our early video analysis suggests that in 11, 12-year-old players, when you actually disallow body checking, their offensive performance skills actually improve. And so for some of these kids who are in certainly lower levels of play and really need to develop some of those other key skills, perhaps there are some advantages there. I don't think we're at the end of the road on this one. I think we have to continue to show that this has a positive effect, not only in reducing concussion risk, but also in improving performance of players in the long term.
And Eric, you mentioned your kids are still young, but do you want them playing hockey? Do you want them playing contact hockey? Have you thought that through?
Well, this isn't, I don't think we're here to say, go sit on the couch. Let's not be part of sport. I think we're here to say, you know what, these things are going to occur from time to time. We're going to do our best to stop them from occurring in the first part. But once they do, let's acknowledge them. Let's treat them as quickly as we can. Let's get them back to school. Forget about sport and going back to sport. Let's get them back to school. Let's get them back to work. Let's start doing this in a shorter time frame. I think it's feasible. But in terms of my kids playing, they'll play whatever they want to play. But I think hockey's a beautiful game, and I'm really encouraged by what we're hearing in terms of the body checking, and you know, really, it makes common. It's you know, kids hit puberty at different levels, and there's a huge gap. I went through it. I played up a year, and this is great news.
And Roger, I think Eric's point is really important. You're not suggesting that we bubble wrap our kids and they do nothing.
Absolutely not. In fact, one of the committees I was on earlier the year was a meeting hosted by the National Institute of Health in Bethesda, Maryland. And it was a lot of the experts around sport and concussion. And the question had come around, what should we do about football? What should we do without? And one of the panelists grabbed the microphone and said, I'm a pediatrician in Philadelphia. And if you look at what the risks of our kids who don't have any activity versus the kids who go into boxing even, the risk of boxing is still far less than those kids who don't get engaged with the positive coaching, the positive outlook, the physical benefits of doing the sport versus staying on the street. And so even in an extreme example like that, depending on the circumstances and the risk, there are still potential benefits for sport. And I think, as we talked about earlier, while there's many concussions in sports, there's still lots of concussions on the playground. We're not going to let kids we're not taking away all the monkey bars off the playgrounds, and we're not going to not let the kids go walking on the sidewalks to school either. So I agree, we need to let kids do the sports, but do the rule changes we need. And then our job as a scientist is to make sure that once they do have the concussion, what are the ways that we can best diagnose them as quickly as we can, most accurately as we can, target those who have the highest risk to these novel interventions to make them better sooner.
But unfortunately, some places are getting rid of monkey bars and stuff. They're taking, you know, covering their butts, if I can say it that way. Isn't there evidence that the more active kids are, the less risk they're going to have because they have skills, mobility skills, et cetera? Isn't there benefit to being active, even if there is a slight risk of concussion and stuff? Maybe we'll ask the kinesiologist, yes?
Yeah, so I think you make a great point, but actually the evidence shows that kids, once you control for their exposure to risk or the hours that they're actually participating in sport, it's those kids who are overweight and that are actually at higher risk of injury than those that are more active. And I think that that's a really strong point moving forward, because our larger epidemic is related to decreased levels of physical activity.
So we don't count the lazy boy injuries, right? Is that the problem?
No, and if, what I've noticed is walking to work every day, passing many playgrounds on my way home, for example, what I see is that kids are surrounding the playgrounds and they're texting. They're on their phones. They've got apps. They're, you know, even when the playgrounds are there, they're not using them. And that's a big problem. So I think that's something that we need to consider alongside risk of injury.
Now, Roger, when I was listening to your talk, I got the sense there's a lot going on, but I also got the sense we're in the infancy of this, right? We don't know a lot about how to prevent concussion, and we don't know a lot, how to treat it. Is that fair?
Yeah, I would still say that the classic iceberg analogy, where you see only the 10% that's above the ice, the 10% of the ice that you see is above the water and the other 90% still down below. I think we're still at the point where I think we're learning, kind of like the Goldilocks analogy. We maybe know what's too hot, and we maybe know what's too cold. We're still trying to find out what's that just right for a lot of these issues. And I think it's something that we've seen tremendous progress over the last decade. I know that it's taken a huge, just like the rates of concussion has increased, the amount of literature that's published has dramatically increased over the last decade. So I think we're on the right track. I think the keys are really taking and building on the work that's been done and taking it to the next level.
Now, you see a lot of kids in the ER at CHEO. Yeah. How can I phrase this? What's the common mistake that they make? What's the one thing you think over and over, boy, if they hadn't done that, they wouldn't be in here? Are there common trends that you see that parents and kids make mistakes that they end up with concussions that should be avoidable?
Yeah, I think one of the things with the kids that we see whose symptoms are really persistent are the kids who haven't really focused on letting their brain recover. And sometimes the analogy is used, you have a gas tank. And if you have this injury, you're maybe starting your day not on a full tank of gas. You're starting it on the half tank. And what we'll often see is kids who came in who had the concussion maybe on Friday, but they only come to the emergency room on Saturday, or actually Monday is the big day we see them, is because they've gone back to school and they've taken exam and then they've spent all day in class and they've used up all that gas that they had in their tank. And I think one of the mistakes that people have is they're putting a lot of their energy into things that maybe aren't the things they need to do. Maybe they are spending too much time doing the video game, which requires a lot of cognitive energy. And they haven't instead focused on maybe get back to school for a couple hours, then go home and get some rest. And maybe they haven't focused on maybe I'm just going to go for a little walk today, maybe with one friend, which gives them that social interaction. It gets them outside. It gets them moving. So I think those are the commonality symptoms that I see are often caused by people whose symptoms are exacerbated by overdoing it, but not overdoing it by the things that they need to be doing, like school, but they're overdoing it by things that they may not need to do.
And Eric, I want to ask you that retrospective question as well. What would you have done differently if you had the knowledge that you have today? How would you have treated your concussions differently?
Well, I wouldn't have... I think I got very lucky in who I saw in terms of concussion treatment. Dr. James Kelly out of Chicago. He was currently in, he was in Chicago when I saw him, and is working with the military down in Maryland now. I probably would have backed off about 20% in terms of physicality, but getting back to Roger's point, I think a lot of this is just common sense. You know, I was just writing down some notes here, and I got looking at the cage, and I kept thinking, what is that movie with Robin Williams, where he walks into the hospital and Patch Adams, and there's a great deal of humor, and there's interaction, and it's not so much what's going on the black and white medicine side. There's the element of socializing and being around friends, and I think that's what you know. Common sense says that. Common sense says, let's not put our kid in the helmet that doesn't fit. You know, let's be on this. Let's do everything that we can. Let's tick off all the boxes that we can that make sense. And if we have a question, then let's go ask.
But Roger said it. Common sense isn't always that common.
That was wisdom.
Yeah, there you go. Now, Roger, you mentioned in passing number 87, not number 88, and the impact of Crosby's concussion. How did you, was it a big, big factor? You said there was a spike in kids coming to.
Well, that was one of the things that we found looking at in the Ontario data. There was a large number. It was near almost doubling again. You know, we doubled over 7 years, and we almost doubled again in 4 years. And that, I think, has, again, not to do with kids are having more injuries or kids are suddenly more fragile. I think it has to do with greater awareness. So I call it the silver lining of this injury for us is that it's increased awareness. It's getting patients into the treatment where they may have just stayed at home on the sideline. And if we could prevent one of those other cases, such as the tragedy of what happened to Rowan Stringer, because now they got the proper education and they did learn and they did seek advice, that's the silver lining of his injury and the fact that we've really increased that awareness. So I think that's probably the take-home point is the fact that the number has spiked probably because of all the articles in the paper and the fact that we have a full auditorium tonight, whereas maybe in 2010 we wouldn't have had. So I think that's these are the silver linings, as I said.
And Carolyn said it in her opening remarks, it takes these champions. It's not the science that's going to change people's minds. It's people like Eric and Sidney Crosby and Rowan's family, which bravely went forward. That's what's going to make the difference. Now, Carolyn, you mentioned a lot of the risk factors. I'm wondering, I didn't hear the word genetics. Is there a genetic factor in concussions? We know that Eric's brother Brett had concussion problems as well. Was that coincidental? Is there genetics in it?
So there's increasingly more work to try to understand why are those that have had a previous concussion at risk of another concussion? Is it related to that previous concussion? Or is it that they were predisposed, be it genetically predisposed? Maybe it's around behavior, psychosocial factors. I think it's multifactorial. And I don't think we're going to have one answer to this problem in terms of prevention and or management and reducing that time to recovery.
Great. So if people have questions, just to wave your arm, we have a couple of people with mics, I'm told, in the audience. We have blinding lights in our eyes, so we can't see anything, but wave your hands and they'll let me know that there are questions. And just to let you know, we're live streaming the event, but we're not going to live stream the questions because we don't have people's explicit permission to put them on air. So we're going to cut off the live stream for people who are listening live to take some live questions.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Dr. Elizabeth Terrio. I'm Vice President, Research and Informatics at the OBI. And it's my pleasure to help wrap up the evening by thanking first our outstanding panel of speakers. And I don't think we can say enough to thank Eric for his dedication and his leadership to bringing our attention and public awareness on concussion. Roger and Carolyn, thank you for sharing your wisdom, your clinical expertise, and your humor with us tonight. It's been a pleasure. Dr. Mikkelsen mentioned in his introduction that Canada is internationally recognized for its concussion research expertise. And Carolyn and Roger are two of Canada's leading superstars. Now, yeah. And you have to know that it takes foresight and it and research funding, actual dollars, to enable Canadian concussion researchers to play on that international stage. And so tonight I'd like to recognize a couple of people in the audience who had that foresight and the ability to direct research funding to Canadian concussion research. Dr. Anthony Phillips, who is the scientific director of Canadian Institute of Health Research. And Dr. Sam Weiss, who's the director of the Hotchkiss Brain Research Institute in Calgary. Our thanks to André Picard for your skillful moderation. C'était formidable, merci bien. And a huge thank you to Michelle Wilson, who is our OBI communications wizard and is responsible for putting together these public talks. Where are you, Michelle? Again, fabulous job. Thank you so much. And then finally, thank you to you, to the audience tonight, for coming out, for your interest, and we hope your support in future efforts towards supporting Canadian concussion research excellence. Thank you very much.